First I want to thank for this wonderful opportunity to present some of our work. And also I want to thank the organizers of this conference and the organization, because I think that it has become a very important hub for this discussion between researchers and researchers and practitioners in our field as it steadily grows. I'm going to present a stress pain experiment. And the first question could be, why is it interesting to study stress? And stress is basically a mechanism by which we interact with the environment. So stress is a preparation for a fight or flight behavior. So as architecture sets the scene for behavior, I think it's appropriate to think that we can influence this mechanism. And here is a diagram of the basic stress mechanisms. And there's basically two stress effector systems. There is the HPA axis over here in one of the blue boxes, which releases cortisol and which can be measured in saliva. And there's a sympathetic nervous system, which is part of the autonomous nervous system, which we have down here. Then there's two different types of stressors. There's psychogenic stress, or means psychologically generated stress, which we have up here. And it's it is triggered by experiential factors or innate programs and controlled by the limbic forebrain, means basically the hippocampus and amygdala that we heard about this morning. And then there's systemic stress, which is triggered by, for example, pain and control of systems in the brain stem and hypothalamus. And you can see also there's a kind of middle control box here, which can control the effector systems. And the systemic stress can even bypass that. So in this case, we had tried to work with systemic stress in terms of pain. And here's a picture from our lab. It's done in a cave, as you can see. And it's very difficult to photograph because you need to have special glasses and a head tracking system on. So you must believe the descriptions I give of what the participant can see. We use the so-called cold pressure test, and over here is a curiostat, a machine which can keep water in a certain temperature, in this case 5 degrees Celsius, within a range of 1 degree. And here's a bucket of water at room temperature, which we use for baseline measurement, and here is device for measuring heart rate variability. And we had a closed room. We had a room with openings where the participant will experience that the floor of the lab continued uninterrupted to the horizon, so there was a potential possibility for flight. And then we also had, in this case, a setting with a view to nature, which of course was that because we, due to the work by Roger Ulick we just heard about, we would expect that there was a lower amount of the hormone cortisol because it's an immune regulatory hormone. And here's a result for the cortisol. And to our surprise, there was actually no, although there's a tendency, there was no significant difference between the three rooms. But when we go to the autonomic nervous system, here we have the heart rate, here we have the parasympathetic nervous system, and here we have the sympathetic nervous system, which shows the stress. And this curve should be read that when the curve is low, the activation is high. And to our surprise, actually, it shows that the natural setting gave the largest stress response. So that, in a way, it's wonderful because as researcher we will always look for anomalies because it's a sign that there's something to be learned. Then I will compare to so experiment we did with psychosocial stress, actually presented here 2 years ago, where we have psychological or social psychological stress test, where a test person has to present do two tasks in front of a committee, and it was done in the same computer model. And if we compare the outcome of the cortisol, we can see that while there was no significant difference in the pain condition, there was in the psychosocial stress. And also what we saw before, it's controlled by two different mechanisms in the brain. So I'll try to put it into a theoretical framework by referring to affordances that we also discussed yesterday, by using also the definition by Andy Clark, who says that affordances are the possibilities for use, intervention, and action which the physical world offers a given agent and are determined by the fit between the agent's physical structure, capabilities, and skills, and the action-related properties of the environment itself. So in both experiments, actually no participant actually tried to get up and escape. That means that it was a possibility for use, intervention, and action which the physical world offered the agent that caused the difference in the level of cortisol in the psychosocial stress, but not in the pain stress. So actually, we should add something to this definition because it also depended on the situation in this case, whether it was pain stress or a psychological or social situation that caused the stress. So what could that mean to the architect? The architect controls, of course, and hopefully controls the environment in terms of being the one who designs it. The architect has a potential influence on the embodied effect of a given space in a given situation through its affordances, but has limited or no influence on the situations that can arise in the space, which depend also on the program, because some programs are more monofunctional than others. For example, it's foreseeable to see which situations that will arise in a hospital, patient bedroom, for example, or in an office space, but in many cases, programs are more multifunctional, and then becomes very hard to predict which situations that can arise. For future research about the thing with a discovery with nature, one question could be, has it something to do with the type of nature that we used? And we actually already had made computer models to try to vary the type of nature. It could also be other things. It could be, for example, that the VR model is not fractalized. We just heard that could be a cause for the effect. It could also be that the effect that we ascribe to nature has to do with something else, for example, how long the line of sight is or something. It was also, of course, a very acute effect. It lasted for a minute or so. So you could also ask if it actually was a bad thing. Could it have something to do with arousal, for example? About the affordances of space, you could also start to ask how wide are we able to generalize from this? Does the effect of space always depend on the situation? Is it only for some types of spaces, for example, in this case, open or closed spaces? or only for some types of situations, in this case related to stress. There could be a lot of other situations arising. And also, if the effect of spaces depends on a situation, what does it mean to our research methods? Because in many cases, which we tend to see, we want to know the effect of a space, for example, with a high ceiling. But if that effect depends on the situation, then it becomes considerably more complex. And often the setting in which we test it will be the situation itself. For example, being put into an fMRI scanner is a strong situation in itself and might influence in itself the outcome of what we try to measure. So this was the word. Thank you for your attention.
Entertain a couple of questions.
Just to answer a couple of your questions there, is it always the same type of nature, different nature? It is different nature because we've done some experiments on changing the Hausdorff dimensionality of the natural image, and that makes a big difference. You get a physiological response at the so-called waterhole dimensionality, fractal dimensionality of nature. You don't get it in other natural views. And also there are other fractal statistics associated with certain natural views that have to do with the sharpness of the image or the roundness of the image. That also affects the physiological responses. So yeah, you're onto something here, and there's a lot of good stuff to explore there.
Yeah, thank you.
Any other questions?
One thing that I thought about after your pain study is that pain is such a strong stimulus it might overwhelm the nuances. And I was wondering more if you look at memory later on or a rating of how painful the situation was, or any other measures, give it a little time and see if the recovery is what matters as opposed to the immediate experience.
About the recovery, then in the cortisol curve, there was also a long recovery period after
the like the next day?
No, not the next day.
Yeah, that's the level I'm thinking of.
Yeah. We didn't do that. But
one more.
Thank you. Where you showed the images where you conducted the test and you had the room with no window and then the room with the window, did it for escape? Does the relationship of the size of the window to the room, is that important, or was there any criteria for how you determined the size of that window?
We don't know. We have just tried to use that own one variable to whether you could escape or not. So that is kind of further research whether what the size. In case of this physiological measures, but if you saw Zacharias' presentation yesterday, he actually worked with the size of the door that you have to go through.